Ladies and gentlemen, it's good to meet you here in this meaningful spot in the heart of Delft, the Prinsenhof. This may well be the most becoming place for delivering a lecture on Frans van Hasselt. As Mayor of Delft, it's a great honor for me to be allowed to welcome you to the second edition of the Van Hasselt Lezing, the lecture named after him. Today, it has been exactly 76 years since Van Hasselt wrote history, delivering an address that made the difference. Please allow me to take you back to the source of the Van Hasselt Lezing, to what took place here in Delft exactly 76 years ago, on the 23rd of November 1940. Delft student Frans van Hasselt expressed his resistance against the dismissal of his Jewish professor, Josephus Jitta. Doing so, he had mustered the courage to oppose the Nazi regime. It was a form of resistance which employed verbal strength for its weapon, not in a provocative manner, but guarded, modest, yet unshakable, because he was convinced that he was entitled, under a duty even, to speak out, although he knew this would not be without danger. It did not restrain him. For among his words addressed to his fellow students, there was the phrase, "Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." This realization lent him the courage to obstruct, to raise himself above commonly prevailing fear. The strength of his words went a long way and resulted in a massive strike of Delft students. In fact, it was one of the first strikes held in the Netherlands. Initially, the occupier was at a loss, but what to do? But eventually, van Hasselt was run in and transported to Buchenwald, where he died 2 years later on the 10th of November 1942. Here in Delft, however, we will not cease to commemorate him, since even today we are still in need of likes of Frans Hasselt in order to be able to make the difference. Since even today there is a lot that can be learned by us from the strength of a moral compass. Certainly in a society that would appear to be growing more and more confused. Since even today, tyranny still appears to be at large. For these reasons, it is good for us to ponder and consider time and time again the events that occur in this world, the many new developments, their impact on our society, and the significance of adhering to firmly established values when entering on those new roads. Keeping important values alive presupposes maintenance and alertness. In this respect, it will prove difficult to find a more inspiring environment than this, the Prinsenhof. Roughly 380 years before van Hasselt, the then occupants of this place, Willem van Oranje, also put a firm plea for tolerance and freedom of conscience and religion, and against intolerance and tyranny. A plea that eventually resulted in the act of abjuration, the so-called birth certificate of the Netherlands. The changes in today's world go like lightning. While nothing remains that until recently would have been considered as obvious, in several years' time, geopolitical relations have been undergoing a drastic change. And in politics, we find ourselves startled time and time again by unforeseen events, or events that so far we preferred not to notice. Meanwhile, technology develops at huge speed, so that everything that would be deemed impossible today will turn out reality tomorrow. Many young people in this university city manage to keep up with all these developments and participate in them. They truly are game for anything with respect to technology. They have no trouble at all acting in this dynamic world, playing chess on several boards at a time, and as if it takes nothing. On the other hand, in many places all around the world, including Delft, there are groups of people who find it less easy to keep up, being under the notion of not taking part in those dynamics and advances, with their instilled certainties going up in smoke. These people start to alienate themselves and they give up trying. It is especially this group of people that might prove an ideal breeding ground for today's new manifestations of tyranny, like hate-spreading one-liners and entire groups of people being blamed for what one doesn't like about this society, for intolerance bred by ignorance, for discrimination against others. Nothing new under the sun when set off against the 1930s, the years preceding van Hasselt's last century plea. The current situation, characterized as it is by increasing division, poses a huge appeal on today's leadership. Leadership in politics, in the governance of our institutions, in company management. What it boils down to is authentic leadership, aiming to serve, practice what you preach, and a daily recurring realization that one person's progress need not automatically imply benefit to the other. It poses an appeal on those responsible in all kinds of positions in society to put in an effort towards more even distribution of wealth and technological development, towards applying ethical considerations regarding progress and those who take profit from it or are possibly impaired by it. In a university city like ours, moreover, it's important for us to actually pass on this realization. In her lecture named Meelopers en Dwarsliggers, Followers and Obstructionists, held on the occasion of the 50th anniversary of Trouw Daily's daily newspaper, Dutch professor of pedagogy, Lea Dasberg, declared that education is also about raising and tutoring. In her opinion, that comprises more than merely passing on a bag of norms. It should imply to shaping and molding of young persons into people disposing of their own will and own choices. Young people can make independent considerations and prevent themselves from becoming mere followers as a result of mutual discussions and discussions with teachers. Having learned to determine their positions in the event of dilemmas, she furthermore called on teachers to be explicit regarding their values and norms and the things they stand up for. Peace and righteousness demand upkeep and maintenance. Linking progress to society as a whole is not a simple affair, but a fine challenge indeed. It covers themes in the combined fields of ethics, technology, peace and righteousness, which together take up a central position in the van Hasselt lecture. What should be given prominence in this respect is moral leadership, which would here imply a passion to make progress and new technological developments come to the benefit of all people. Ladies and gentlemen, history will repeat itself and will remain topical. As a consequence, let us learn from the sacrifices also made here in Delft. Let us make an effort towards arriving at a keener insight and wisdom, and in doing so, do justice to the words and deeds of van Hasselt. I wish you a very inspiring evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor van Bijsterveldt. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the Delft University of Technology, I welcome you warmly at the second Van Hasselt lezing. For those who do not know me, I'm Tim van der Hagen, president of the TU Delft, as we usually say. As Mayor van Bijsterveldt rightly observed, the world is longing for peace. In fact, the city of Delft and the rest of South Holland surrounding it have a great historical tradition of thinking about ending wars and bringing about peace. 500 years ago, in 1517, Erasmus of Rotterdam wrote his famous treatise, The Complaint of Peace. Erasmus had seen with his own eyes how new weapons, new technology in other words, turned large parts of Europe into a bloody battlefield. He argued that arbitration would cost a fraction of waging war. So this is what he advised kings and rulers to engage in. Later that century, in 1583, the founding father of international law was born right here in Delft, Hugo Grotius, Hugo the Groot. His contribution to thinking about an international moral order can hardly be overestimated. Then there is Spinoza, one of the great inspirators of the Enlightenment, providing the moral cornerstones of Western democracy and human rights. Spinoza lived in Voorburg for a number of years, around 1665, and Voorburg at that time was actually under Delft administration. There's a clear line in the Dutch history of ideas and tolerance on peace from these South Hollanders like Erasmus, Grotius, and Spinoza to the peace conferences in The Hague of 1899 and 1907. But then we come to the day that we are remembering here today, a cold and gray November morning in 1940. On that day, student Frans van Hasselt made his way to the civil engineering building to give a speech that would most certainly not please the Nazi authorities. But van Hasselt did not consider himself a hero and never wanted to become one. The Nazis had decided to ban Jewish professors from Dutch universities, among others the very popular Jewish professor Josephus Gita, would no longer be allowed to teach in Delft. Frans van Hasselt and his fellow students saw this as a great injustice, and yet another manifestation of a morally corrupt regime. Hundreds of students came together that day in the civil engineering building, but Professor Gita was not even allowed to hold his farewell lecture. That is when van Hasselt climbed the grand stairs in the hall and expressed what many felt about the Nazi ideology and its victims, although his friends had warned him it would be a bad idea to speak out in public. We know what followed. His speech inspired the first student strike in the Netherlands against the Nazis. But van Hasselt himself was arrested and imprisoned. He died in Buchenwald in 1942 at the age of 29. There are still physical reminders of this troubled period. Close to the Frans van Hasselt room in our aula building hangs a painting of Frans van Hasselt. It was made by his aunt in the 1930s and given to the TU Delft in 2004. There is, among others, also a bronze plaque in the hall of the aula with the 180 names of those who died at the hands of the Nazis. And in 2014, we unveiled a memorial plaque in honor of Frans van Hasselt at the Oostplantsoen, where the civil engineering building stood back in 1940. Now, van Hasselt made a moral choice in times that were chaotic and morally confusing. The Second World War brought moral dilemmas for all students in Delft. How do you respond to the Nazi occupation, knowing that resistance could be met with brutal retaliation? Do we just carry on, as if nothing had happened? What about solidarity with Jewish fellow students and professors? Should we sign a declaration of loyalty required by the Nazis for those who want to carry on with work and study? Those were the questions facing the academic community back then. Historian Onno Sinke published a book on this subject in 2012. It is called Loyaliteit in Verdrukking, which means as much as loyalty under fire. He was asked to write by our university and by a group of former members of the Students' Association, the Delft Studentenkorps. Last year, a group of students performed a play based on that book. It was called Getekend, which in Dutch has the double meanings of both signed and marked. It is good to see that our students are still involved in this subject, not only because we should not forget what happened in those terrible years, but also because the questions we are facing today are often not so very different from those back then. Students of all times are confronted with moral dilemmas, even when the dramatic setting of a world war is absent. Many of our students today will have the chance to work on technologies that may change the world forever. They may find themselves working as engineers in some unruly and remote corners of the world. They may travel to conflict-ridden areas to fix infrastructures. They may have dealings with people who do not follow high moral standards, or they may have to sit at the table with people who do not even intend to comply with minimum legal requirements. At TU Delft, we think it is of great importance that our students learn to think systematically about the rights and needs of people who might be affected by their work, here and now, and in distant places and times. To make them think about human well-being, human dignity and responsibility. Technology is always the means to an end, not an end in itself. So while we work on these means, we should also think about the acceptability of the ends. For this reason, we have established the Frans van Hasselt Lecture that commemorates the moral courage of one of our students, and at the same time makes us reflect upon the moral responsibilities and ideas of a university of technology. Because if history teaches us one thing, it is that the future needs us today. So let's now take a look at that future. Robotics and artificial intelligence, nanotechnology, genetics, bioengineering are just some of the fields that may change our lives drastically. They come with ethical implications. Just think about the debate on stem cells and embryo research. Big data is not a such field. To many, it holds great promise. It may be used to create early warning systems to prevent diseases, or to prevent crimes from happening, or even to fulfill our desires before we become aware of having them. To others, it poses a threat. What about privacy and cybersecurity? Personally, I would feel more than a little spooked if, based on my internet searches, my doctor's surgery would phone me for an appointment instead of the other way around. And to talk to us on just this subject, the dynamics of big data and human rights, Professor John Tasioulas of King's College in London is with us today, and we are very pleased to have him. So before I give the floor to Professor Tasioulas, let me briefly introduce him to you. John Tasioulas is Professor of Politics, Philosophy and Law at King's College London. He studied law and philosophy at the University of Melbourne, and both moral philosophy and international law are subjects that he has always remained interested in. These two subjects meet in the topic of human rights, one of his many research interests. Because if there is such a thing as universal objective morality, he reasons, can we then realize that through an international legal order that ascribes rights to all individuals? One of his other many research interests are the ethical questions arising in biomedical research and practice, also a subject we are concerned with at TU Delft. In fact, as broad as the research interests of Professor Tasioulas are, just as long is the list of his accomplishments and the prestigious positions he has held. Among others, he was a lecturer in jurisprudence at the University of Glasgow, a tutorial fellow in philosophy at Corpus Christi College, Oxford, and quaint professor of jurisprudence in the Faculty of Laws at University College London. He is a co-editor of the Philosophy of International Law and is now working on a monograph on the philosophy of human rights. And he's also a great presence on Twitter. Only last week, he tweeted he was very honored to be giving the Van Hasselt Lecture here today with us in the birthplace of Grootjes. Professor Tasioulas, let me tell you that we are at least as honored to have you here today. So please, let's welcome Professor Tasioulas to the podium, but not before we have enjoyed a musical interlude. Thank you very much.
That's the first time I've had three such difficult acts to follow. It's a great honor to be invited to give the Van Hasselt Lecture. I say this in the first instance as a firm believer in human rights, but I also say it as someone proud of my Greek heritage. Greece is a country whose people mounted a courageous resistance to horrific Nazi occupation and who heroically sought to safeguard its Jewish community. So I can't help but be moved by the inspirational story of Frans van Hasselt, the story of his bravery and his self-sacrifice. These are qualities that, unfortunately, as it turns out, we desperately need even today. It's also very moving for me to be here in Delft, the birthplace, as the president said, of one of my great legal philosophical heroes, Grotius. In pursuing my work on human rights and the foundations of international law, I am deeply conscious of the fact that I am following in his footsteps. And in a very specific way, I interpret him as someone who's trying to bring a broadly Aristotelian picture of ethics and use it to defend something that seems very contemporary and modern, which is the notion of rights. So he remains for me a huge inspiration. Now, the title of my talk is The Dynamics of Big Data and Human Rights. And I'll try to make this vast topic slightly more manageable by limiting it in two ways. First, by focusing on how this dynamic plays out in the specific context of scientific research, in particular health research. And second, by concentrating on two human rights. First, the well-known right to privacy. And second, the less familiar right to science. But before we can discuss the dynamic relationship between big data and human rights, let me say something about each of these terms. So first, big data. As we all know, digitization has radically transformed our lives. The internet, mobile devices, massive data collections, and the analytics applied to them are propelling a digital revolution. The World Economic Forum refers to it as a fourth industrial revolution. And there are many interrelated facets to this digital revolution, but at its heart lie the increased capabilities to amass and store data, and the analytical models applied to them for yielding knowledge. This is the big data phenomenon, a phenomenon that is rapidly advancing, pervading increasing areas of human existence, from how life insurance is decided to the sentencing of criminals, and one that seems to be here to stay. Yet the apparently inexorable rise of big data has provoked sharply conflicting responses. At one end of the spectrum, we find unbridled enthusiasm about the proliferating opportunities to improve our lives. At the other end, there is increasing alarm at the pressures and distortions to which big data applications subject our established patterns of life. For every opportunity that big data presents, there seems to be a counterbalancing anxiety. So on the one hand, some of the most beneficial applications of big data are expected in the area of biomedical research and public health, early detection of disease outbreaks, identifying the genomic underpinning of diseases, and discovering patterns of side effects of blockbuster drugs are just some of the areas in which big data applications have delivered promising results. But on the other hand, the Snowden revelations about government surveillance have underscored growing fears about how certain uses of big data can undermine not just privacy, but ultimately trust, democracy, and liberty. The stream of reports about hacked databases, data kidnapping, and other cybercrime have stoked fears of a new vulnerability in the digital age. And so, the pressing question arises, how can we harness the potential of big data while keeping faith with our ethical values? Now, often, the appeal to ethics is interpreted as a conservative gesture, one hostile to scientific progress. I unfortunately encounter that attitude sometimes among scientists. But it's a bad mistake to view ethics and science as inherently in tension, to think of ethics as just a series of roadblocks on the path to scientific progress. Because science is itself inherently an ethical enterprise. Ethics is about goods that we have reason and perhaps sometimes even an obligation to pursue. This includes the good of knowledge that can be used to bring about significant improvement in health and other dimensions of human well-being. In this way, health research is an ethical enterprise from the very outset. After all, it would be deeply uncharitable to regard scientists engaged with big data, for example, as merely pursuing their narrow self-interest, whether defined in terms of monetary enrichment, satisfaction of curiosity, or career advancement. Instead, they are seeking public goods, goods that benefit all. But there are, of course, ethical considerations bearing on how we may properly pursue those goods. And these considerations very centrally include human rights, but not only human rights. So let me turn now to the other term in my title, human rights. And I begin with the two rights I mentioned at the outset, the right to privacy and the right to science, as they appear in the Universal Declaration of 1948. So first, the right to privacy. Article 12 of the Declaration states, no one shall be subjected to arbitrary interference with his privacy, family, home, or correspondence, nor to attacks upon his honor and reputation. Second, the right to science, or as some people call it, the right to science and culture. Article 27. Everyone has the right freely to participate in the cultural life of the community, to enjoy the arts, and to share in scientific advancement and its benefits. Now, unlike the right to privacy, the right to science is for most people an unfamiliar right, but it's one that has, I think, massive unexplored potential. It has two aspects, both the idea that everyone has a right to benefit from scientific advances, and the idea that people have a right actively to participate in scientific inquiry. Ordinary people have a right, in other words, not just to be passive beneficiaries of advances made by professional scientists, but to engage in scientific research themselves. So although a right of popular participation is a familiar idea in the realm of democratic politics, the right to science takes the idea of participation much further. The result is that participation infuses and potentially radically transforms our modes of scientific practice and our culture more generally. And in fact, I think the two are intimately related. I think a genuine democratic culture has to draw on a broader culture, a broader civic culture, where there's real participation by all people, not just by a limited group of experts. Now, in recent years, technological developments have enabled increasing numbers of people who are not professional scientists to exercise their right to participation, sometimes as part of a movement called citizen science. So in the area of health research, devices that collect and transmit data about individuals have facilitated the exercise of this right. Health research produced by citizen scientists, often connecting on online platforms, usually engaged with rare diseases that are not profitable enough to attract the attention of pharmaceutical companies, research conducted by these citizen scientists has actually appeared in leading scientific journals, including, for example, Nature. Now, both the right to science and to privacy, as I've just described them, are binding norms of international law. And they're also given force by laws of regional and domestic jurisdictions. Behind these legal manifestations, however, lies human rights conceived first and foremost as moral rights. In other words, we didn't need law to tell us we have a right to privacy. That is first and foremost a moral right. A moral right possessed by all human beings simply in virtue of their humanity. And it's these background moral norms, these background moral norms of human rights, that control the proper interpretation of the rights to privacy and science in human rights law. So let me say something about how I think we should understand these background moral human rights, the foundations for international human rights law. So in the confines of this talk, what I want to do is briefly make four observations about these. An observation about the grounding of human rights, the values that justify them, an observation about the content of human rights, the duties associated with them, an observation about the bearers of human rights duties, who's responsible to comply with these duties, and finally, I want to stress the incompleteness of human rights. So to take those four points, regarding the grounding of human rights, I think we need to accept two ideas. The first idea is that human rights norms are not fundamental. Instead, they owe their existence to how they protect other values, deeper values. And second, any given human right does not typically protect one master value. So some people say there is only one master value, human dignity. I think that's wrong. I think typically human rights protect a variety of values. So for example, the right to privacy protects a variety of interests. Our interest in being able to make life choices without interference or surveillance, our interest in not being humiliated, in forming and maintaining intimate relationships, and so on. Equally, the right to science also serves a multiplicity of interests. These include the interest in acquiring knowledge of the world, the interest in achievement, in the case where the knowledge is acquired through one's own successful efforts, the interest in community with others, because science typically involves participation amongst colleagues who cooperate towards the shared goal of scientific knowledge. The second observation was about the content of human rights, what they require of us. A human right, I say, protects our interests, usually a multiplicity of interests. But it's not the same as those interests. The human right identifies the extent to which the protection of our interests imposes a duty or an obligation on others. The duty specifies what the duty bearer must do or refrain from doing in order to comply with the right. So the duty associated with the right is its content. And this is very important. The interest that the right protects versus the duty associated with it. And here's an example that brings it out. If I'm in dire need of a kidney transplant, my interest will be greatly served if someone gives me their spare healthy kidney. But I don't have a right to that kidney because that person does not have a duty to serve my interest in that way. It would be good if they did that. It would be admirable, perhaps, but they would be doing no wrong in refraining from giving me their spare healthy kidney. So the process of specifying duties associated with rights is a very complex one. The starting point is the thought, ought implies can. So a person can only be under a duty if it is feasible, practical, to impose it upon them. To begin with, It must be generally possible for duty bearers to do what they have the duty to do. There can be no duty to do the impossible. So even if in theory certain security measures, such as foolproof anonymization of data, would enhance my interest in privacy, there is no right to them if there is no way to implement those measures given the current and foreseeable state of technological capacities. In addition, even if it is possible to do something, imposing a duty to do it must not be unduly burdensome. So it's not just possibility, but burden that is relevant in determining whether a duty is feasible. So for example, my interest in privacy doesn't impose an obligation on the police not to require me to disclose my identity to them if they find me behaving suspiciously. Recognizing such a right would be unduly burdensome in relation to other important values, such as the detection and prevention of crime. Or back to our original example, my right to life does not include an obligation on your part to give me your spare healthy kidney, as this would be excessively burdensome for you. The third point, the third observation, concerns the question, who bears the duties imposed by human rights? Now, human rights law, especially international human rights law, treats the state as the exclusive or at least the primary duty bearer. But there is nothing in the underlying idea of a moral human right that restricts duty bearers to the state and its organs. Some rights, such as the right to a fair trial, might be primarily targeted at the state. But non-state actors, ranging from individuals to transnational corporations, may also bear human rights duties. And this has been powerfully underlined recently by the United Nations in its guiding principles on business and human rights, which were endorsed in 2011 as political rather than legally binding principles. These are the brainchild of John Ruggie, a professor at Harvard. The guiding principles directly impose an obligation on corporations to respect human rights, irrespective of what their legal obligations may or may not be. This is one of the most innovative moves in contemporary human rights practice, and it totally bypasses the state. It says, corporations, no matter how big, how small, transnational or not, directly must respect human rights. Human rights are not fundamentally statist, nor are they fundamentally legal. They're moral requirements that can apply to a diversity of entities. Now, this latter issue is of special relevance to big data for several reasons. Corporations engage in massive data collection that stretches over many national jurisdictions. They possess powerful computational tools that are opaque to outsiders. Given the accelerating pace of developments in big data, national laws designed in the analog era may be inadequate to protect rights affected by big data. Big data companies, therefore, have responsibility to respect human rights even when law does not explicitly demand such protections, and that is what the Ruggie principles, the principles on business and human rights, make very clear. Equally, corporations have a right to respect the right to science. For example, corporations with control over large scientific data repositories tend to have exclusive legal rights to their use. Even if they exploit the data for scientific purposes themselves, they may have an obligation to make such data sets available to other researchers, because that would further the right to scientific progress. Final point, the fourth point I want to make about human rights, is as important as it is neglected. Although human rights are important and weighty moral standards, they are incomplete. They do not exhaust all of the ethical standards relevant to law and public policy. To begin with, there are duties that are not associated with rights, such as duties to oneself, duties to develop one's talents, duties to preserve one's health. There are also duties of charity, duties of solidarity. The breach of these duties is a moral wrong, but no particular person, no particular right holder is wronged when that happens. In addition to the domain of duties, Law and public policy needs to be responsive to a whole range of ethical concerns, including the fulfillment of human needs, economic prosperity, the preservation of nature, the furtherance of the common good, beyond the point at which any of these concerns generate duties, let alone rights-based obligations owed to some individuals. Now, I think it's vital to stress this incompleteness point, the fact that human rights do not exhaust everything of moral concern, because otherwise we lapse into the error of pressing human rights to do all the ethical work that needs to be done, which risks distorting them while simultaneously marginalizing non-rights-based considerations. So part of my work on human rights has been to try to save human rights from this constant pressure to expand them to encompass every moral claim you want to make. And if you do that, if they encompass everything, they lose their distinctive force. I turn now to the topic, the dynamic relationship between big data and human rights, now that we have these two terms on the table. And I wanted to emphasize two levels at which this dynamic relationship plays itself out. So at a very general level, I want to argue that human rights are not fixed once and for all. Instead, they interact with changes in the broader social context we inhabit, including the shifting profile of dangers and opportunities that confront us, and the knowledge and technological capacities at our disposal for meeting them. So our human rights can change as, among other things, big data science changes. That's the general point. And then a more specific point, big data developments can stimulate interactions among human rights themselves, affecting the content of different human rights and the relations between them. So to the first point, contrary to what many suppose, human rights are not ahistorical and unchanging. Instead, they can evolve over time. And the reason for this is one we've already encountered. Human rights, having a human right, depends on what is practically feasible, what is possible, and what is not excessively burdensome. But what is feasible changes over time as circumstances change. Thanks to technological evolution, climatic change, new modes of economic production, social organization, and so forth. Now, digitization and big data, as I said at the outset, are major upheavals in the conditions of contemporary life. This means that new human rights can come into being that did not exist before. And one example is the right to internet access, as proposed by Frank LaRue, the UN's special rapporteur on the promotion and protection of the right to freedom of opinion and expression. Existing rights can also change shape. For example, the right to health may encompass new forms of treatment as their cost declines over time, such as antiretrovirals, thereby rendering the duty to supply the treatment not unduly burdensome. The sad news is the changes need not always be in a positive direction. New circumstances can mean we lose human rights we formerly had. In one grim scenario, perhaps ongoing climate change will mean that we will no longer be able to affirm a right to an adequate standard of living, because this simply becomes impossible to secure due to lack of resources. Instead, we may have to speak only in the end of a right to subsistence. So this is one of the main challenges of human rights thinking. It requires those who are serious about human rights to scrutinize the conditions of life, the ever-changing profile of opportunities and risks. And it goes without saying that part of the difficulty here is that this is a multidisciplinary endeavor. Human rights is not the monopoly of any one discipline, no matter what the lawyers tell you. I turn now to the second, more complex dynamic. Developments such as big data can change how we see relations between rights. So consider now our two rights, the right to privacy and the right to science, and how they relate to each other. The right to science and the right to privacy may appear to be in tension, in conflict. The right to science demands that opportunities be made available to participate and benefit from scientific advances. In some areas, however, such advances can be achieved only through the use of identifiable data that carries a risk to privacy. Can the right to science be in conflict with the right to privacy? Is there a duty both to enable the use of identifiable data and at the same time a duty to protect privacy that prevents the use of such data? If these duties are in conflict, what is to be done? Are we to trade one right off against the other? And how is that trade-off to be determined? So we quickly move into this scenario where we talk about trade-offs of rights. Now, I think it's a mistake to jump to this conclusion that one right can be secured only if another is systematically violated in the process. Before embracing such a drastic conclusion, this idea of rights in perpetual conflict, we need to take a step back. Specifying the duties imposed by human rights is, I think, a holistic process. Duties can't be specified one at a time, but have to be specified as a totality. So it's a matter of solving a simultaneous equation with multiple variables. Human rights impose duties, and duties are stringent moral reasons that are not regularly or easily to be overridden by other considerations, including by other duties. To think of human rights as habitually subject to trade-offs, therefore, is to misunderstand their nature as sources of duties. It follows that the duties associated with human rights must be in general jointly satisfiable, with conflicts arising only in very exceptional, emergency-like circumstances. So apparent conflicts, like the one between the rights to privacy and to science from which we started, will disappear or can be preempted if we adequately specify the duties associated with each human right. So to illustrate the point, let me use an example of great contemporary relevance, the application of big data analytics to electronic health records. Now, the maintenance of electronic health records is increasingly becoming standard practice in healthcare. The primary purpose of electronic health records is to store patient information that is used in clinical care of patients. But electronic health record data from a large number of patients can be easily pooled together, linked to other databases, and queried with important scientific questions. To date, however, electronic health record data are underutilized in health research and public health practice relative to the benefits they're capable of generating. One of the reasons for this underutilization is worries about privacy. The analysis of data may reveal patterns, behaviors, health risks concerning individuals or groups, and the disclosure of such information can have adverse consequences for them. For example, it can be used to discriminate against them or to stigmatize them. Protecting privacy interests, such as keeping their health information confidential, shields them from these risks. But on the other hand, making the information accessible to third parties is necessary for many scientific advances, and it can further people's interests to share in and benefit from such advances. So how is this tension to be resolved? Well, one way of easing this tension is by asking individuals if they're willing to undertake a privacy risk in order to contribute to the advance of scientific knowledge. This is typically done through informed consent procedures and the authorization of one's health information for secondary uses. So that's one mechanism. A second way of easing the tension is through the anonymization of data, which prevents data being associated with particular individuals. Unfortunately, both of these approaches are of limited utility. It is often impractical to seek consent every time a research question emerges, while a very broad consent for general data users is not really morally robust enough to cover unanticipated uses. Meanwhile, to allow people to opt out by not consenting stands in the way of valuable scientific research. since significant opt-outs introduces a risk of selection bias. Anonymization, the second method, on the other hand, may be undesirable depending on the research project. It might be that the project needs identifiable data. And in any case, re-identification may soon become possible as new capabilities or computational methods emerge. So rather than these two solutions, I think we should think of a third, more radical way forward, and that is to ask whether the right to privacy is to be specified in a way that it actually poses a significant obstacle to the right to science, in particular in the use of data from electronic health records. Consider then the right to privacy in health research. The interest that it serves, for example, the interests in non-discrimination and non-stigmatization, do not necessarily have to be served by conferring on the right holder exclusive control over the flow of their data. Another way to protect such interests is by shifting the focus onto the conditions under which certain uses of data are to be regarded as permissible. And here are some conditions that I think could permit the use of data without prior authorization, without prior consent. First of all, data-driven research, like all other research, must be socially valuable, and its benefits ought to be fairly shared among the community. Second, data users should not subject data to queries that create excessive risks, and if they do, the information gleaned should not be released to any parties that might use it to harm the person in question. Third, data users commit to full transparency about data uses and related actions. And finally, one's interest in not being harmed through discrimination may be better protected by regulation that punishes discrimination or through other means that serve as a deterrent to discriminatory activity, including compensation mechanisms. So the solution I'm sketching here considers privacy interests only insofar as they concern certain harms, such as discrimination, resulting from privacy breaches. But we can easily imagine someone making an objection at this point. Someone might argue, even if there's no harm of stigmatization or discrimination resulting from privacy loss, doesn't the person have an autonomy interest, in others not being able to access their personal information without their consent? And isn't it plausible that this autonomy interest is protected by the right to privacy, so we have a duty to use the information only with explicit permission? Now, I believe it's doubtful to suppose that this is always the case. Even if one has an interest in not having their information ever accessed without permission, it may not always generate a duty on others to respect that interest, that key distinction between the interest and the extent to which it imposes a duty. Are we really to say that the autonomy interest is of such surpassing value that there is a duty to respect it no matter how great the potential gains to be derived through scientific research using that information? This seems to me implausible. Now, of course, this still leaves us with the question, a moral and political question, of deciding when the potential gains of research are so great that there is no countervailing obligation to give people a veto on the use of their data. I say it's also a political question because it can't be answered exclusively in the philosopher's study, but needs to become the subject matter of a democratic decision-making process. We are back now to that other aspect of individual participation in democratic politics. This, of course, is merely the sketch of a proposal, but it suggests the broad direction in which I believe our thinking about human rights and big data needs to move. So allow me to conclude. The emergence of big data is a dramatic example of how scientific and technological innovation generates both enormous potential benefits and also grave risks. In responding to the challenge of securing the benefits whilst minimizing the risks, we have to engage in ethical thinking that is just as innovative as thinking in science and technology. In particular, we should not confront these scientific developments with a dogmatic understanding of human rights that is fixed and unresponsive to changing circumstances. Instead, we have to think creatively about how human rights, such as the rights to privacy and to science, might need to be revised to meet the challenges of this fourth industrial revolution. Thank you for your attention.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm the last thing between the Van Hasselt Lecture and the drinks. That's not the most pleasant place to be, especially if you've been listening to such an excellent lecture as we just had from John. It made me think, and it raised a lot of questions. I will not raise them to you, at least not to this audience, but maybe to John later. But that human rights are not fixed in time was clear for me before your lecture. But that big data has such a big influence on the relationship between those human rights, I did not realize. And for me, it emphasizes once again that making courses in ethics obligatory to all our students is something we should keep on doing. That's the path we're going. Most of our students get ethics in either their bachelor's or master's programs, but we will see to it that in the future this is an obligatory part of all our courses, and that's what we are working towards, I can tell you. Then another good news I have related to, let's say, the bearer of duties with respect to rights. As you said, this is the state. And I agree with you, not only the state, a lot of our organizations as well. But if we look at the state a little bit wider than just the state in this country, we can look at Europe. And the good thing is that Europe, with the program of Commissioner Moedas on open science, just started a program to implement many of these things. I've had the honor to be appointed in the Open Science Policy Platform in Europe, advising the Commission twice a year on open access of data, open presentation of data, fair data, open access of publications, but also on citizen science and old metrics, looking differently at the way scientists behave. This is a difficult topic, but an important topic, and it also bears on the duty, I think, of this case, the state of Europe, the Commission, to help people with their right to science. And especially the domain of citizen science is a difficult one to fill in. Does it mean that every citizen can ask for the same sum of money as every scientist can? Well, they can, but most likely they will not get it. So how do we fill in citizen science in a proper way? Contribution of citizens to science is all around us already, and big data is an important part in there. So there's a lot of stuff to talk about, and I would like to thank John once again for his excellent lecture. One more last remark to be made, because we are in the beautiful Van Mandelezaal, and it's not the normal surroundings you find with all these plastic tools around us. This is Theo Janssens, who has his exhibition here in the museum, but also across the square here at the other side, where a lot of his work is being shown and a lot of explanations are given to how he works in relation to this material. There's one in the corner, Amaranthus orbis, and that's the one you can use. You can pull it, you can push it, and then you can feel how these animals behave, how they walk. And across the square, you can learn how these animals taste the salty water and then decide to walk in different directions without any electronics, all mechanically, all made by plastic, and all driven by wind. So with that, I would like to invite you for the drinks and hope that you find some inspiration. If you have not seen the exhibition yet, you should do it. Thank you for being here.